Gentlemen, right now we will to start the international lecture series with the base of academic and best practice with the time leadership and technopreneurship for decision making in business. With the famous speaker today, Dr. Engineer Roger Niyah, Master Management, Senior Lecturer and Head Department of Management at SA Unggul University Jakarta, and Simwan GPhD. University Kuala Lumpur's Johor, MyTech, Malaysia. And thank you very much for you coming, speaker. Appreciate to your time. And participant, I will to inform you, jangan silent je. Saya guna bahasa Malaysia sikit ya. You can to use chatbot for you silaturahim and introduce about you lah. Supaya dapat kawan baru daripada SA Unggul Jakarta ni. And juga Jakarta boleh kenalan saya nama ini dari kampus program study ni, my email ini. Jadi saya harapkan kalian di chatbot ni, student ni, Uni KL maupun SA Unggul, boleh jumpa kawan baru lah. Supaya esok you pergi dekat Jakarta ke, pergi dekat Johor ke, you ada kawan baru. Jadi jangan silent je. Jadi nak tambah kawan is best lah. Okay, saya harapkan kita semua sihat dan control your sound, jangan bocor ya. Yeah? You can to mute code ya. Yeah? Thank you. And the second, let's we look at the short video of ILC. Nanti end boleh lihat di situ dari Universiti Kuala Lumpur ada Prof. Emeritus Azmi, ada lagi Prof. Azanam yang baru meninggal juga namanya itu dalam Board of Trustees. Okay, Indah Gumilang will be to share the song. So, Anji, itulah short video about ILC. If you want to know more about ASEL Lecturer Community, you can to click www.asellecturer.com. Tanpa membuang masa lagi, Ibu Dr. Insinyur Rojuaniah, Master Management, dipersilakan menggunakan masa 30 ke 35 minit. Sila, Bu.
Terima kasih, thank you for this opportunity. Terima kasih atas kesempatan untuk sharing ilmu kepada mahasiswa, baik mahasiswa SA Unggul University of Kuala Lumpur maupun Universitas SA Unggul. Saya juga mengucapkan terima kasih nih pada Prof. Tengku Sahrul Reza sudah memberi kesempatan dan salam kenal buat Encik Sim Wanji. Baru pertama kali kita berjumpa. Jadi sharing hari ini saya topik yang saya bawakan tentang servant leadership ya, servant leadership. Oke. Okay. Sebenarnya saya share screen untuk tentang PPT tentang servant leadership.
Silakan. Di layar sekarang sudah sangat jelas, Bu. Warnanya oke, okay, biru dan hijau.
Oke, perkenalkan mungkin dari mahasiswa SA Unggul sudah kenal sama saya, tapi kalau dari mungkin dari University Kuala Lumpur gitu ya, itu baru pertama kali bertemu dengan saya. Jadi saya Rojuaniah ya dari Universitas SA Unggul dan dosen dari SA Unggul, dan kebetulan sekarang diberi ya diberi tanggung jawab untuk memimpin program studi manajemen. Nah, sebelum kita masuk ke servant leadership ini, kita tahu dulu ya, we have to know about what is the leader, what is the leadership. Yeah. So the leader, gitu ya, the definition of leader is someone who leads or direct other people, yeah, or a group of people, yeah. Nah, so the leader have ability to influence the others. The leader have to make a decision that impact the group, yeah. dia example of leader of head state, leader of CEO ya, of company, or yeah, we all a leader. We all a leader because we have to make a decision. We have to influence the others. Yeah, so we are all the leader, but we have to know about the leadership. Yeah, leadership. Leadership is the process of directing and influencing other to achieve a common goals. Jadi harus apa kalau seorang tadi kalau misalnya seorang pimpinan itu dia mengarahkan ya orang lain gitu ya, kemudian bisa mempengaruhi orang lain, itu orangnya ya, a leader, someone. But leadership itu adalah prosesnya ya, proses untuk mengarahkan, directing, influencing, mempengaruhi gitu kan, supaya mereka bisa mencapai tujuannya. Ini saya pakai dua bahasa karena di sini ada mahasiswa yeah. Esa Unggul ya. 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 Nah, jadi leadership itu leadership is not just about leading others. Jadi bukan hanya memimpin saja gitu ya, memimpin orang-orang aja, tapi juga harus bisa membuat hubungan yang positif dengan antar mungkin antar atasan dengan bawahan dia gitu ya. Jadi tadi di dalam leadership itu selain adanya keputusan ya, keputusan pembuat sebagai pembuat keputusan, juga dia juga harus bisa merencanakan ya, merencanakan itu tadi, merencanakan apa yang akan menjadi tujuan dari organisasinya atau visi misi dari organisasinya. Jadi ini prosesnya. Jadi kalau leader is orangnya, someone, tapi kalau leadership is process. So ada banyak tipe-tipe, there are many type of leadership ya, yeah, leadership style. Yang paling terkenal ya, yang paling banyak dilihat orang ada transformational leadership, so transactional leadership gitu ya. Ada otoriter ya, otoriter. Jadi there are many style of leadership. Nah, untuk pertemuan ini kita akan membahas tentang servant leadership. Salah satu tipe dari leadership ya itu servant leadership. So, what is a servant leadership ya? Yeah. Atau apa kalau bahasa Indonesianya kepemimpinan melayani, kepemimpinan melayani, tapi lebih enak bahasa Inggris ya, servant leadership ya. Kalau kepemimpinan melayani Indonesia agak gimana gitu. Servant leadership, a style of leadership that emphasize service and care for team members. This includes respecting and listening to the needs of team member, ensuring they have tools and resources they need to do their best work, and give them opportunities to develop their skills and talents. Nah, ini pertama kali dikemukakan tentang servant leadership ini oleh Robert K. Greenleaf. Jadi yang pertama kali yang mengemukakan tentang leadership ini yaitu Robert K. Greenleaf ini. Ya, di dalam bukunya Servant as a Leader. Jadi ini dia tahun 1970. Jadi kalau Pak Tengku Sahrul mungkin udah lahir ya.
Sudah, saya 62.
Oh, 62. Sama saya juga sudah lahir ini. Oh. Nah, ini jadi ini servant leadership ya, kalau kita lihat jadi di servant leadership ini dia respecting ya, jadi dia respecting, kemudian listening ya, jadi mendengarkan, menghormati, mendengarkan dari kebutuhan dari anggotanya maksudnya bawahannya gitu ya, dan meyakin bukan mengucap istilahnya tuh meyakinkan ya, bahwa mereka mendapatkan ya peralatan atau sumber daya yang mereka butuhkan supaya mereka bisa bekerja dengan baik. Dan selain itu juga mereka memberikan kesempatan kepada bawahannya untuk yang mengembangkan skill mereka, talent mereka. Itu adalah ciri dari servant leadership. Ya. Walaupun mungkin agak mirip-mirip juga sih sebenarnya dengan transformational leadership. Nah, kemudian kita lihat gitu ya. Sebenarnya karakteristik ya, karakteristik dari servant leadership itu apa sih ya? Ya, jadi karakteristik that are typically associated with servant leader. Ya, jadi di sini di dalamnya tuh ada empathy. Ya, empathy. Jadi kalau misalnya empathy itu kalau di apa bahasa Indonesianya empati ya. Empati. Jadi dia si pimpinan ini, the leader ini dia bisa memahami gitu ya, memahami dan dia bisa merasakan kebutuhan dari anggota timnya. Jadi ada empati. Jadi di sini dia bisa selalu mendengarkan, kemudian mempertimbangkan dari bawahannya ya, pertimbangan dari bawahannya. Dia mendengarkan pertimbangan dari bawahan. Kemudian karakteristik yang lain adalah kolaborasi. Jadi collaboration, collaboration. Jadi di sini collaboration ini apa kerjasama ya kerjasama. Jadi si pimpinan ini selalu mendorong anggotanya untuk selalu bekerja sama, untuk selalu kompak, gitu ya supaya dia bisa apa mengembangkan atau supaya mereka anggota-anggotanya itu selalu bekerja sama dalam mencapai tujuan dari organisasinya. Itu collaboration. Nah, yang karakteristik yang ketiga itu long term focus. Jadi fokus dalam jangka panjang. Jadi apa yang dia lihat itu bukan hanya fokus ke jangka pendeknya, tapi dia melihat jangka panjang. Jadi di sini dia misalnya gini, mereka memberikan pelatihan kepada anggotanya gitu ya. Itu dia fokusnya yang dilihat dalam jangka panjang ini si anggotanya ini akan menjadi apa gitu loh ya. Dia akan mendorong anggotanya untuk apa berinvestasi supaya keahliannya bisa dimanfaatkan untuk jangka panjang. Untuk jangka panjang maksudnya dalam mencapai tujuan dari organisasinya. Long term focus. Jadi fokus jangka panjang. Jadi dia melihat sesuatu itu apa sesuatu sesuatu itu yang melihatnya keuntungannya adalah ke manfaatnya untuk jangka panjang. Kemudian yang keempat adalah ethical behavior. Jadi perilaku etis. Jadi dia melihat gitu ya, melihat integritas ya. Jadi atau perilaku etis. Kemudian dia berkomitmen ya, berkomitmen terhadap apa aturan-aturan yang memang sudah mereka tetapkan. Jadi di sini ethical behavior. Ya. Ini karakteristik dari apa? Dari servant leadership. Nah, selanjutnya kalau ini kan Robert K. Greenleaf ini kan yang pertama kali yang mencetuskan servant leadership. Di Robert K. Greenleaf itu justru dia awalnya gitu kan ya dia melihat 10 karakteristik dari servant leadership. Jadi kalau tadi ada 4 gitu ya. Ada 4 yang dilihat gitu ya yang terkait dengan servant leadership, tapi di Robert K. Greenleaf justru dia di awal dia sudah melihat ada 10 katanya. Ya, 10 karakteristik dari di servant leadership. Jadi ke-10 itu pertama ada listening. Jadi listening ini berarti mendengarkan. Jadi pemimpin itu harus bisa mendengarkan. Mendengarkan maksudnya mendengarkan masukan-masukan, ide gitu kan ya, kebutuhan apa yang diharapkan dari bawahannya, ini listening. Nah, kemudian empati, ya, empati. Kalau tadi kan empat secara apa setelah dirangkum. Nah, sekarang kita lihat 10 yang dasarnya yang dari 1970. Jadi kalau saya lihat sih sebetulnya lebih enak kita melihat yang ke-10 ini ya. Jadi di sini tadi empati. Jadi empati itu ya kalau kita lihat seorang pemimpin itu harus memahami. Jadi di servant leadership pimpinannya harus memahami, merasakan gitu apa yang ada di benak ya dari anggota organisasinya. Kemudian healing se Indonesia healing ya healing. Jadi healing itu ya kalau kita healing itu apa ya? Kalau istilah kalau di Indonesia itu kalau refreshing itu jalan-jalan itu healing gitu.
Iya, tapi ini healingnya bentuknya atau recovery atau penyembuhan
recovery. Jadi recovery. Kalau di Indonesia itu kalau orang-orang muda itu jalan-jalan gitu, healing gitu. Ya. Jadi iya. recovery.
Refreshing.
Jadi di sini di sini jadi membantu dia bisa membantu mengatasi atau permasalahan atau konflik ya dari di antara mereka di antara musuh di antara dari pimpinan itu membutuhkan antar bawahan dihilik. Nah, kemudian awareness jadi dia juga harus di Indonesia itu kesadaran istilahnya kalau ditranslatekan ya diterjemahkan gitu ya jadi sadar akan perasaan dia sendiri gitu ya dan dia juga tahu kebutuhan dari orang lain gitu loh ya. Nah, selanjutnya tadi listening sudah persuasion ya persuasion. Jadi ini si pimpinannya harus mampu gitu ya, mampu meyakinkan orang lain. Jadi melalui pendekatan ya dan meyakinkan orang lain berdasarkan visi-visi gitu ya, kan ini di organisasi ada visi-visi, visi organisasi kan, visi misi organisasi. Nah dia harus bisa mampu meyakinkan itu organisasinya gitu ya terhadap visi dan misi yang atau tujuan dari organisasinya. Jadi persuasi pendekatannya terhadap bawahannya, ya. Nah kemudian conceptualization. Ya, konseptualisasi Indonesianya ya. Jadi dia bisa melihat gambaran besarnya secara abstrak gitu kan ya terhadap jadi dia bisa berpikir ya, berpikir secara abstrak melihat gambaran secara besar terhadap apa yang menjadi permasalahan di organisasinya ya. Jadi itu conceptualization. Jadi konsep melihat konsep-konsep yang ada jadi bisa melihat konsep-konsep dan menggambarkannya gitu loh ya. Nah, kemudian foresight ya. Jadi meramalkan. Jadi bisa meramalkan tren yang berkembang ke depannya seperti apa itu. Jadi di sini dia bisa melihat ke depan istilahnya. Nah, kemudian stewardship. Jadi di sini dia bertanggung jawab ya atas sumber daya yang dipercayakan kepadanya. Nah, itu stewardship. Kemudian yang selanjutnya adalah commitment to the growth people. Jadi di sini dia berkomitmen ya untuk mengembangkan anggota organisasinya gitu loh ya. Kemudian supaya anggota organisasinya lebih profesional. Nah, ini commitment to growth of people. Kemudian yang terakhir adalah building community. Jadi membangun komunitas. Jadi dia membangun kebersamaan ya dalam tim dan anggota organisasinya. Ini karakteristik dari 10 karakteristik dari servant leadership. Nah, jadi ini nanti kita lihat sebenarnya bisa melihat pimpinan-pimpinan, our leader itu, apakah mereka servant leadership atau tidak gitu ya. Nah, kemudian di sini juga kita lihat gitu ya, tentang lima ya, lima. Jadi istilahnya tuh five practice of exemplary leadership ya, yang dikembangkan oleh by James M. Coase and Barry Z. Foster. Jadi dia ini sebenarnya buku ya, buku, tapi bukunya itu five practice ya, ini tadi five practice of exemplary leadership. Ini sebenarnya buku, tapi dia pendekatannya adalah pendekatan leadership style ya, leadership tadi ya, servant leadership. Jadi di sini menurut si James and Barry ya, Coase and Posner ya, Coase and Posner itu ada empat ya, ada lima, sorry, and courage the heart, kemudian model the way, inspire a self vision, challenge the process, enable other to act. Ya, di sini apa ada lima gitu ya, ada lima. Nah, di sini misalnya model the way. Ya, jadi sebenarnya di Indonesia menjadi contoh model the way. Ya, jadi dia harus bisa menjadi contoh, ya, menjadi contoh. Tadi kalau misalnya dia punya perilaku etis, jadi dia mencontohkan perilaku yang etis, gitu ya. Dia harus membuat standar perilaku yang etis. Jadi dia sebagai contoh, jadi menjadi model. Nah, kemudian inspire a shared vision. Jadi dia memberi semangat kebersamaan. Ya, semangat kebersamaan gitu ya, jadi bisa menjelaskan visi dan misi gitu loh ya, kemudian apa memberi semangat gitu ya untuk pencapaian visi dan misi gitu ya, jadi dia bisa mengungkapkan, menjelaskan gitu visi yang dari organisasinya ya, kemudian dia mendorong orang lain untuk bekerja mencapai visi yang sudah ada gitu ya, yang sudah ditetapkan bersama. Nah, ini namanya inspired a shared vision. Kemudian challenge the process. Jadi di sini si pimpinan itu dia berani mengambil risiko pada saat proses ya dalam melaksanakan pekerjaannya ya, dalam dia melakukan memimpin, dia dia apa berani ya, berani atau bersedia mengambil resikonya. Nah, kemudian yang terakhir enable others to act. Jadi di sini bisa apa bisa melayani dan mengakui ya kontribusi dari anggota timnya. Jadi di sini kita lihat ada lima ya, lima menurut Coase and Posner. Nah, sekarang siapa sih gitu ya, kalau kita lihat sebenarnya pemimpin, the leader who has implemented servant leadership style ini, servant leadership style. Jadi kita lihat pimpinan-pimpinan dunia ya, yang saya lihat dunia kan ada juga yang dari Indonesia kali ya. Jadi di sini contohnya yang menerapkan yang di leadership servant leadership style ini contohnya adalah Martin Luther King contoh ya, itu jadi di sini tokoh diskriminasi ya, anti rasial diskriminasi dari Amerika ya tahun 1960 gitu ya. Nah, kemudian Mahatma Gandhi ini yang pertama sebenarnya harus disebut karena dia memang seorang pimpinan gitu ya, dia yang melayani dari anggota organisasinya. Ini yang paling terkenal, Mahatma Gandhi. Kemudian Mother Teresa, contoh lagi ya dari India. Kemudian Steve Jobs. Ya, ternyata Steve Jobs ini juga menerapkan servant leadership. ya, Steve Jobs. Jadi dia yang merupakan founder atau CEO dari Apple ya. Jadi dia punya visi dan dia merupakan seorang pemimpin yang inovatif. Selanjutnya ada Jack Welch ya, Jack Welch dari GE gitu kan ya. GE gitu ya, dia apa menerapkan gitu ya servant leadership. Ya. Saya kira itu
Ya,
sharing dari
hebat Ibu
saya
ini.
ya, tidak terlalu panjang.
Hebat Ibu. Time
Ya, terima
management-nya
kasih.
bagus. Good Bu. Time management Ibu bagus banget. Saya baru aja mau bilang ada 5-4 menit lagi, malah sudah ini. Berarti Ibu betul-betul memperhatikan waktu, karena orang manajemen selalu time management bagus ya Bu ya. Oke, okay, thank you very much for sharing, Ibu. Dan before the second speaker sharing, sure.
Okay, now is my turn. Okay, boleh nampak slide tak?
Okay, your screen is very clear, very clear. Ada green, orange, and lain-lain.
Okay, okay. Here, today my chapters, right, is about entrepreneurships and also sustainable growth. Okay, because normally when we talk about entrepreneurships or technopreneurships, so some students, they might get confused. What is actually technopreneurship? Because if you check dictionary, maybe they don't have it. Okay, but actually technopreneurship is a combination between technology and entrepreneurship. Okay, but after that, we have a so-called ecosystems, and then we have some sustainable goals that actually apply, okay, for technopreneurships. So first of all, in order to identify what's the differences between the entrepreneurship and technopreneurship, I'm not going to use the very academic methods like all the definitions. I let you see what it actually a product. Okay, from a product, you can have a different types of entrepreneurships that apply for individual product or individual branding. So first of all, you look at this. Okay, I believe that most of you are quite aware of this brand, right? Danny Wellington's. Okay, it's a very simple watch. And then we have a Seiko. And then this Seiko, they have a different so-called subsidiaries brand under Seiko. One of them is Grand Seiko. And then we also have a so-called Apple Watch, which is a very popular digital watch that available in the market. So you can see here, a one product, but it comes with different prices. Okay, and then every items, right, they have their own technology. They have their own model. Their business models in like making the business work and making their product reach to their customers. Okay, at first I'm going to introduce the founders, okay, of Danny Wellington. Okay, at first when I search Danny Wellington's founder, definitely will be Danny Wellington. Actually, no. Okay, Danny Wellington's founder dear adalah Kai Sanders. He's a very young age. He's only like 2 years older than me, 1985. So this watch, right? But you can see here, this part. He's a Swedish Swedish businessman. And then his product, Danny Wellington. The watch is designed in Swiss, but it's manufacturing in China. And then certain parts is from Japan. So from this part, right, you will see some things. A lot of like innovations actually origin from Asia. Can you see that part? The design may be from Western, from continental country, but when it comes to the implementation and the manufacturing of the products, most of it is from Asia. Okay, like they make it in Asia, they use the technology from Asia. So actually Asia, when it comes to technopreneurship, they are more, I would say that they're advanced in a form of so-called machines, okay, and applications, okay. But of course, when it comes to concept, the Western will be better, okay. So the next one is Seiko, the founders, okay. Kintaro, okay, in late around like 1959, lah, okay, he introduced one, the world's first quartz watch. Because maybe majority student, they might not know that last time our watch, we are using automated watch. Yeah, automatic, no battery. Okay, so Seiko, they invented the first quartz watch which used battery, and then they bring revolutions. And then what kind of revolutions that apply in the watch industry is like last time everyone used so-called automatic watch. Actually, last time, watch is a tools product. It's a tools. It's alat. Okay, we don't take it as a fashion. We don't take it as luxury. But after the quartz managed to bring some revolutions in the industry, they bring crisis to the Switzerland. Okay, as the Swiss country that actually that make the watch. So a lot of like companies that make watch that bankrupt, they close out their business or they collaborate with others. Okay, and then they have to figure how they're going to beat Seiko. So they change. They change the way that, of course, I cannot beat Seiko in technology. I can beat them in positioning. So they change. So most of the Swiss watch, like Rolex, they move to luxury piece instead of a tools watch. Okay, so this concept you understand. Okay, so this part, right, I can assume that Kintaro, they also involve some technopreneurships, okay, in designing their product and bring some industrial revolutions to these products. Okay, and then now the latest ones, Apple Watch. Okay, when Apple Watch being released, it become one of the best selling wearable device, electronic device. And then you can see that part. Actually, sir, I have to tell you, this watch, even though they are made in, they are like designed in California, but they are still manufacturing in Vietnam. Why? Why they want to manufacture in Vietnam? Because let me tell you one thing. First of all, because of Vietnam's, they have a so-called a lot of government policy actually to support the technopreneurships of like setting up all the infrastructures in so-called manufacturing and produce these products. Okay, so that is a part. Okay, because whenever when we talk about technopreneurships, we are not focusing the individuals, but we are focusing the whole plant. Okay, so we have to look into every single details, because later on, students and audience, you'll please pay attention, because right, these ones will be very important, because we have academics here. So the academic have to put in some technopreneurships elements into your teachings and learnings. Okay, so if you look at this, okay, one Seiko, Daniel Wellington's, Apple's, they have entrepreneurship, technopreneurship, intrapreneurship. Then each of them, they are focused on different things. For example, VW, they are focused on the online sales. Okay, whereby Seiko, they are focusing on their watch innovations. They're designing their watch. And then for Apple's, they are focused on digital innovations. So they're totally different, but they're still category under technopreneur. Okay, and then here, if you look at the most valuable companies in the world, most of them, they have relationship with technology, like Amazon's, Google's, Apple's, Microsoft, Samsung. This is all the company that we all aware, and this is the most valuable brand in the world in 2020. Okay, so you look at now, most of the product that we have now, technology items, most of the time, they are from this brand, this few brand. And then if you look at the top 10 most valuable Indonesia brand, okay, Telco, bank, okay, and then some part of it, they are focusing on some traditional business. But in order to like overcome this, we have to put in some technology in so-called technology elements in it. Because right, what I can see here, there are a lot of like Indonesian startup, they are started to focus on technology, okay? If you, I didn't put it the so-called examples here, but if you refer to a lot of Indonesian startup, especially from universities of Bandung, a lot of the entrepreneurs, the business startup, unicorn companies, they are majority so-called technology oriented companies. And then if you look at Malaysia, we have Petronas, Bank, Genting, Tenaga Nasionals, all these kind of companies, they are some part of it, they are still adopting the very traditional business. But of course, okay, traditional business is not saying that traditional business is not making money. They're still making money. But the point here is, for the younger generations, they have to look into the technology parts, okay? Because if we are not looking for the technology parts, how are we going to like bring out a new economy, okay? So that is the part, the important thing that I want to share here. And then here is we need to identify the ecosystem of technopreneurships, because most of the time, in my own point, when I've been experienced during these times in like lecturings, I realized one thing. Students, they all have their ideas about technology. But just a point that they might not have sufficient exposure, or they might not have sufficient funding. So that's why, right, funding is very important. Okay, so if you have a good ideas, you receive the fundings, you can realize the ideas, and then you look for some technology sourcing. For example, you can source for some technology, whether they can OEM for you, or you can like have some kind of partnership with them in order to get up one so-called final products. And then validation and consultation of IP transfer. Okay, this IP refer to the intellectual property. Because sometimes students may wonder, or people may wonder, technology, technopreneurship, it is must have something that related to IP. Yes, sometimes it's up to us to determine whether you want to relate it to IP or not. Because IP is definitely something to protect your business, to protect your product, and to protect your idea. But if you have a very good idea, so you figure out that someone might copy your ideas, please patent it. This one is good for you, and they're trying to cover the development and the growth of your technopreneurships. And then technology incubations and operation centers. Okay, I believe that nowadays, the governments, right, they do have a lot of like facilities, and also like even like universities, right, they have these incubators. They will try to foster the technopreneurships among the students, or even among the outsiders, and even they're trying to help others to transform. Okay, because some businesses, right, they are doing certain business, but they can't really reach a certain levels. So they have to transform. They have to put in some new technopreneurship for allow them to move to a higher levels. And then nurturing and value-added service, business, marketing, and technology advisory. This is somehow, I would prefer say that this is more on business side lah. Okay, and then trainings, capacities, this, all this part, right, even the entrepreneurship development programs, I can assure you that all these kind of like things, right, our students, especially like training, okay, advisories, program developments, okay, even somehow certain form of networking inside our campus, UniKL, we can easily get it. But somehow the major problem is like maybe our students, they might not aware that they require these kind of resources in order to help them to achieve higher levels of technopreneurship. Because for them, they might just think, okay, I just simply do online sales, I just simply do this. But they never know that they can try to get a lot of benefits from the universities. Okay, try to make use of it. Because universities, they are not longer served as a place to provide knowledge, but they also provide some good experience, especially the universities that have collaboration with industry, okay, or they have government's backup, okay? And then the next thing is, why Asians have to foster on technopreneurship is because, right, let me tell you one thing, is that there's a lot of companies actually, they are moving out from China, and then they're moving to Malaysia, Vietnam, or Indonesia, Thailand, okay, why? Okay, first of all, because these few countries, they have a so-called high, medium, and low skill labors. Okay, and then all these kind of like skill labors is quite crucial in foster their technologies developments. Okay, so most of the companies, they are moving out. Like example, Samsung, they are moving to Vietnam. Apple, some part, they are moving to Vietnam. Okay, and then even like somehow Tesla, they say that they're going to propose to have a plant in Indonesia. Okay, so you will see all these things, we will assume that it's a technology transfer. Okay, this technology transfer definitely need sufficient technopreneurship to take over the knowledge or the technology transfer from that companies, and then we make it localized. Okay, and then here you can see Apple accelerate the plans to move more manufacturing out of China. So we, as the other part of the Asia, that we're going to benefit from it. And then you can see 7 companies that have left China have entered Republics of Indonesia. So this is all the advantage. Because why? Okay, this is somehow my own point of view. Now, the presidents of so-called Indonesia, they're already planning to move the capitals from existing Jakarta to another place. I think they're going to name it Nusantara, right? So this act, right, actually they will like, it's an attraction point for a lot of like big companies, okay? Like Apple, Tesla, a lot of big companies, and even small industry, okay? Enterprise. So for them, they will see it as one opportunity. So that's why when you look at this, right, as opportunities, that universities have to play their roles. So universities, we have to figure how we're going to make our students are well prepared for these types of developments. Okay. And of course, Malaysia, we don't have some projects. Okay. We have projects. One of the projects from Johor is like Forest Cities. Okay. We have Malacca's. Okay. Projects. There's a few things. And then we also have one, Porsche. Porsche has established their assembly plants in Kedah. If I'm not mistaken, it's Kedah or Perlis. It's part of Malaysia. Okay. So here, when you look at that, right, then you might wonder, technopreneurship locals, what we can like do with that? And then how universities are going to play roles in technopreneurships? Let me tell you one thing. Majorities of the startup executive, they all have graduates or high degrees, majorities, or at least they have bachelor degrees or lower degrees. Okay, why this part, right? I mean that education play very important roles for this kind of like startup or technopreneurship is because, right, a lot of things okay, that we share to our students, okay, they will capture the knowledge and then they apply in their business or they apply in their entrepreneur pathway. Okay. And then here, this is all the few subjects or I would say that so-called some industry, they are highly reliant on this kind of degrees for startup, not for just simply getting the so-called employee. Okay. And then one thing that I want, now we already finished the part of that entrepreneurships, but now we are entering the sustainable goal. Okay, this sustainable goal is not set by me, but it's under UN. Okay, so this UN, right, United Nations, that they are trying to like establish 17 goals that they're going to transform our worlds. Okay, so this one, right, normally we do not have a lot of lecturers that actually introduce these 17 goals to the students. And then later on, when our students have any good ideas, they cannot like merge these 17 goals into their objective. Actually, this part is very crucial and very important. Okay. Like I managed to help like last year, okay, I bought some of our students to attend some competition in China. Okay. And then one of the criteria is this. The students, they have to create some innovations. They have to fulfill some of these 17 goals. Okay. So this is some of the examples that you can see, like examples, Ecovative. Okay. This Ecovative, they are using mycelium. Okay. Mycelium is like mushrooms. Okay. To make it into a new packaging form. And then we milk. They grow milk, but without getting any cow. And then of course, Grab is a very common thing that nowadays. Okay. And then we have another one. These companies like Mycotech is from Indonesia. They are using tempeh. They're using tempeh to make into leather. So this is a very creative ideas. Okay. So this requires huge, huge of technopreneurships. They are not longer at the entrepreneurship levels. They are more on technopreneurship levels. Okay. So I hope that one thing, if let's say can, right, most of the lecturers, we are not simply giving lecturing in class. If we can't, we try to bring our students to attend some competitions. When you attend competitions, you will see other campuses and other students and even the industry player, how they manage to bring their innovation alive. Okay. Like after I attend this competition, this is a competition that initiated by SJTLU, Xinjiang Jiaotong Universities from China. And then the prizes is 500,000 RMB. It's a very huge prizes. And then what he encouraged is they want to make this work. They are not longer just simply, okay, you present your idea, that's all. After they realize that your idea is working, and then they will send people to talk with you, and then they will like make the idea work. Okay, so actually we need a lot of competition like this. Okay, so these competitions allow the students to open their mindset, to open their eyes, to see something that different from the class. Okay, so actually, in my last presentations, my very first of these parts, I will say that if we can, we try these subjects, right, when we talk about technopreneurship, entrepreneurship, we have to bring our students out of the class. Okay, we have a lot of knowledge, we have a lot of exposure outside the class, not within the class, because entrepreneurship subject is actually not a class subject, but there will be more on, okay, out of the class subjects. Okay, that's part from my side. Okay, thank you, Chairperson.
Wow. amazing, amazing. Amazing presentation. Wow. Good idea. Okay, right now, there is some question in my email. I will to read for the two speakers. The first, untuk Ibu Rojunia. Ibu, boleh dengar suara saya? Saya nak baca pertanyaan. Okay. Okay. Bu, ini ada dua saja. Pertanyaannya ada 5, 6, 7, tapi saya ambil dua-dua untuk masing-masing speakers. Ini ada dari Lani. Servon sangat menarik sharing Dr. Insinyur Rojaniah tadi. Saya macam baru dengar juga servant leadership, dia bilang. Okay. Servant leadership sebagaimana Ibu sampaikan, setelah saya coba pelajari, mempunyai beberapa kriteria, di antaranya adalah kecerdasan, melayani, berpikir holistik, punya morality dan spirituality. Namun dewasa ini kita menyaksikan sedikit pemimpin yang demikian. Di Indonesia, mungkin juga di Malaysia, justru yang banyak minta dilayani pemimpinnya, kemudian berpikir ini kena feedback, bahkan berpikirnya sempit, malah bersikap kejam kepada bawahan. Betul. Seperti yang sedang berlaku Jenderal Sambo sekarang, ada tingkat jenderal sudah. Sebenarnya fenomena ini apa kiranya yang dapat Ibu beri komentar ya? Aha, itu pertanyaan dari Lani, Bu Melani. Kemudian nih dari Nita, 10 karakteristik servant leadership tadi yang Ibu sudah sampaikan, ada satu yang menarik saya adalah building community. Sering kita jumpa pemimpin yang jarang pemimpin mempersiapkan bawahannya untuk menjadi pengganti yang lebih baik, justru lebih menekan potensi bawahan supaya tidak tampak dia menonjol, dan ini sama sekali tidak menggambarkan apa yang seharusnya seorang pemimpin. Apakah ini karena kepribadiannya atau karena organizational behaviors-nya? Nah, itu pertanyaan, Bu. Oke, itu kemudian untuk Dr. Sim Wanji from Nita. Very interesting sharing, Dr. About technopreneurship and sustainable goals. People talk that entrepreneurship more about business activities. The another way, David Osborne sharing theory about entrepreneur government. A government not selling something mean a business activity and government activity the same goal to satisfaction of citizen or consumer. So content of entrepreneurship not just only talk about money but more about values, mean how the best we can to create service by heart and good attitude. What do you think about this perspective? Itu dia the first question from Nita. And then from Febri, regarding technology in or in entrepreneurs, many students right now, think that we must create business by technology or better silent. The another side, there is newcomer entrepreneurs start first business with manual and conservative action, like open cafe, outlet, and like it. Is it wrong way to start off entrepreneurship right now? Itu. Okay. Only two questions for every speaker. Okay. Dimulai dari Ibu menjawab dalam 5-6 minit untuk dua pertanyaan itu.
Jadi kalau tadi servant leadership ya. Jadi itu salah satu gaya kepemimpinan. Jadi gaya kepemimpinan. Hmm. Jadi kalau salah satu berarti banyak gaya kepemimpinan yang lain. Nah, kalau tadi dicontohkan Ferdi Sambo gitu kan ya. Kita lihat dulu di mana dia komunitas dia, maksudnya tempat dia, organisasi dia seperti apa. Jadi kalau misalnya di apa apa militer militer itu dia kan mesti taat kepada pimpinan ya, pada pimpinan. Jadi cenderung ke gaya kepemimpinan otoriter yang dibangun.
Taat kepada pimpinan apa kepada hukum, kata Huta Barat Irma.
Oh ya, taat kepada hukum dan kepada pimpinan, kecenderungan seperti itu. Jadi tadi kalau Ferdi Sampo tadi ini kita contoh dia di militer. Jadi militer, kecenderungan kalau militer itu berdasarkan research itu adalah otoriter. Jadi itu kan banyak macam itu kepemimpinan itu, gaya kepemimpinan. Yeah. Nah, kalau kita kalau misalnya kita mau melihat gitu kan, itu kalau kepemimpinan itu bisa dari ada dua teori ya, bahwa kepemimpinan itu gaya kepemimpinan itu bisa dipelajarin. Kemudian ada juga yang apa timbul sendiri gitu deh, dari bawaan dari orang yang bersangkutan gitu. Nah, tapi gitu ya, setiap orang itu punya gaya kepemimpinan masing-masing ya, gaya kepemimpinan masing-masing. Jadi seorang pemimpinan bisa bermacam-macam kepemimpinan, gayanya, gaya kepemimpinannya. Nah, kalau ke Ferdi Sambo mungkin itu tadi dia tadi karena ini apa mungkin terdesak gitu ya, terdesak maka dia bisa dia tidak memikirkan gaya kepemimpinan lagi kalau orang sudah terdesak gitu. Jadi di situ kita jangan melihat seorang atasan yang sampai menembak bawahan gitu loh ya. Itu karena situasinya berbeda. Tapi kita melihat bahwa seorang pemimpinan ya itu tadi secara garis besarnya gitu.
Jadi,
ya
maksudnya jadi seorang itu jadi itu bukan servant leadership tapi setan leadership ya, Bu.
Setan leadership. Terdesak. Yeah. Kalau sudah situasi terdesak, tidak ada lagi, tidak timbul lagi gaya kepemimpinan, tidak masuk ke ranah gaya kepemimpinan lagi. Jadi sudah emosi, sudah setan tadi yang masuk.
Iya, Bu. Ya, oke, nomor dua, Bu.
Yang nomor dua gitu ya, jadi komunitas ya, jadi membangun komunitas.
Kenyataannya seorang malah pemimpin menekan anak buah yang cenderung lebih cerdas dari dia dan kayak gimana itu?
Oh iya, lebih cerdas dari dia. Nah kalau ini kan kita kalau seperti itu ya sudah timbul ego, jadi bukan gaya kepemimpinan nah, lagi
disebabkan,
yang
dia tanya itu lebih disebabkan kepribadian dia ya, atau organization behavior. Jadi
behaviornya, jadi itu ke cenderung ya behavior dari masing-masing. Jadi sudah tidak melihat lagi gayanya. Jadi udah otoriter.
Dia tanya, jadi, Bu, dia tanya tadi itu lebih karena private personality dia atau ya, karena dibentuk oleh organization behavior. Jadi kayak misalnya kepolisian itu kan sebenarnya organisasi kan pengayom masyarakat. Ya. Pengayom, gimana mau mengayom masyarakat anak buahnya aja nggak bisa diayom gitu kan? Jadi itu gimana? Ya silakan.
Iya, personality kali. Personalitinya.
Bukan karena organization-nya.
Bukan ya. Karena organization.
Oke, lah. Jadi
karena kalau jadi sebenarnya kalau kita lihat itu kan budaya organisasi, kalau kita kaitkan kepemimpinan dengan budaya organisasi gitu ya. Ini bisa kepemimpinan itu akan bisa mengubah budayanya atau budayanya bisa mengubah pimpinannya. Itu bisa kalau kita penelitian itu artinya bolak-balik gitu.
Iya, yeah,
saling mempengaruhi.
Ya, jadi yang bagus mana, Bu? Pemimpin membentuk budaya organisasi atau budaya organisasi membentuk pemimpin?
Jadi kalau seorang pemimpin itu bisa dua-duanya ya. Jadi kalau seorang
Oh.
pemimpin itu kalau dia memimpin dengan baik, dia bisa membentuk budaya organisasi, maka budaya organisasinya akan lebih baik gitu. Tapi
Ya.
kalau ini kalau budaya organisasinya yang kuat, siapapun pimpinan yang masuk dia akan mengikuti arus budaya organisasi yang ada. Jadi siapa yang
Ya.
lebih kuat?
Ya. Kalau di Malaysia, Bu, Tun Mahathir itu menyuruh lihat ke timur. Nah, itu kan pemimpin
Hmm,
membentuk
betul.
budaya. Betul
Iya.
kan? Jadi,
Tapi
look east. Nah, ya.
pemimpin
Jadi, jangan
membentuk
lihat barat.
oke.
Jangan lihat barat terus. Dan look east, katanya gitu, Bu, ya.
Tapi kalau budaya organisasinya sudah kuat, siapapun pimpinan yang masuk gitu, dia akan
Ya.
mengikuti budaya organisasi yang ada.
Betul, betul. Bagus, Bu. Makasih jawaban yang sangat smart. Right now, Mr. Simplicio answer to question for you. Right?
Okay, regarding the first questions, mentioning that the governments and also the entrepreneurships. Okay, first of all, you need to understand. I think Dr. Rojona dah answer, dalam governments, dia ada servant leader, dia ada syaitan leader. So if let's say your technopreneurships, your new technology, that is really you get a good leaders to see that is a good opportunity to improve the national economy, then they definitely they will open their door for you. But we take examples like Grab companies. Grabs actually in the first stage when they establish their companies, Grab is actually an illegal business. Why? Because according to Akta Malaysia, Akta Pengangkutan Malaysia, we are not allowed to fetch customers using normal passenger car. You need to get a license, like taxi, bus drive, bus, or maybe bus pekerja. Only that's this a few vehicles that can fetch customers. But we as a car, I mean a household car, we are not allowed. But because of this Grab company is a very innovative company, so the government opened the door for them. But why they don't want to stay in Malaysia, but they move to Singapore to set up their company headquarters in Singapore because they can get better resources there. And then they take it as a stepping stone and then they move to Singapore, move further to US and listed is NASCAR. Okay, so that is the thing that somehow technopreneurship, one thing. Don't always think that technopreneurship, you want to serve your nations. Okay, we serve the nation, but we don't serve the governments. One thing, so you have to understand this concept. Okay, because sometimes if the governments open the door for you, okay, accept it. But if let's say the government, they try to restrict you, then maybe you can have to go somewhere else. Okay, this is the first question. And then the second question is regarding nak buat business ke tak nak buat business. I will say that if you are not entrepreneurial mindset, normally entrepreneurial mindset, when you face problems, or kita cari jalan, bukan cari problems. Okay? That's the things that I want to channel to our students. When we are facing a problems, right, we are looking for the solution. Like examples, if you want to start your cafe, but tapi tak ada duit, never mind, you can start at a small business. You jual tepi mana pun boleh kan? Okay, you can sell, like examples, car boot sales. So that's why we have students that start up car boot sales coffee. Then they go somewhere else and then they do cardboard sales coffee and then sell their coffee at the price of $5. And then they told me, sir, no stress. They don't need to stress how much initial capital they have to invest in set up their restaurants. Because in Malaysia, if we want to have one cafe, let's say, just now you mentioned cafe, around the students, they have to spend around 200,000 Malaysian ringgit
wow.
to set up. To buy all the ingredients, to do renovations, to all the procedures, even to pay the salary, everything, 200,000. But it's just cardboard sales. You can reduce a lot of costs, and then the selling price of the product remain the same. Right. So that's always we are looking for solutions. Kita cari jalan, bukan cari problems. So this is my answer.
Okay, you must be to the problem solver, not problem collector. Jadi, very smart answer from Encik Sim. Okay, before the close.